adds a bit more texture and excitement and interest and makes it a bit more dynamic, all the adjectives. Hello everyone and welcome back to my channel. My name is Tara East. I'm a lecturer, a YouTuber, and the author of the mystery novel Every Time He Dies. And in this week's video, I want to answer some more Q&A questions. So a few weeks ago, I posted a video where I was answering questions that students had shared during workshop. And since that video went up, I have done some additional workshops at high schools, and I have received some additional questions since then, and I thought that I would do another video in the same kind of format. First question, how do you start a book and make it seem interesting from the very beginning? Now, of course, there is no one easy way to make the beginning of a story interesting. What's going to be interesting is going to be largely dependent on the genre you're writing and the audience you're writing for. So for example, if you're writing a middle grade book or a book for young adults, then it is advisable to start in the middle of the action. Start in something that seems really intriguing, really interesting, and is going to hook the reader. Now, this doesn't need to be connected to the main source of tension in the book. You can start the book at some kind of high point, some sort of high tension, interesting point, but this doesn't necessarily need to be like the premise of the novel. We might start with an incident, and then we're going to have this lull where you introduce the characters and the settings, and you sort of establish the world, what's going on, and then you can start to rank up the tension again. So that opening source of tension, it might be connected to the main source of tension that's continuing on throughout the novel or the main source of conflict, or it might not. You don't have to be committed to it in that way. Of course, all of this is around execution. You wouldn't want to start your novel with some point of tension that is completely random and completely pointless to the entire story. But whatever is going on in that moment doesn't necessarily have to have a direct connection to the other conflict and sources of tension within the book. So how you would approach this is going to be, of course, very different depending on the audience you're writing for or the genre you're writing in, as well as your own style and voice. Now, a beginning can feel slow if you are including a lot of exposition, if you're trying to establish the scene, you're describing the setting, you're describing the characters, it's very day in the life. However, this approach would be very appropriate in, say, a literary novel. My main advice would be to start in the middle of the action. Now, I think we have all heard this advice. If you feel as though the beginning of your novel is not interesting enough, then you may need to consider starting in the middle of the action. If you start with, say, exposition, and it's status quo sort of information, daily, ordinary life for the character, and you're just introducing the setting and introducing the character, and it's all a bit kind of like dawdling along, then you might want to consider moving the story forward so that we're in the middle of the action. So the action doesn't have to be directly connected to the main source of tension or conflict in the novel. It can be something else that is happening. Now, this something else should still be functioning and serving some kind of purpose in the novel. It should be still revealing information about the character, their life, or their circumstances, but you don't have to carry through on that same note, let's say, throughout the rest of the novel. So for example, let's say we're writing a middle grade book. So you might open the book with a child experiencing bullying at high school. So we're opening in the middle of the action, some sort of like interaction is happening with the bully. It's resolved in some way by the end of that scene. And then we're kind of like dipping into a valley. So that's like the high tension point that you're opening with chapter one. The first page is this interaction with a bully. And then we're dipping into the valley. And then you're introducing a little bit more around the story ideas, the character, the setting. We're getting more established within the world that you're creating here. And then the narrative is going to continue on from there. We're going to ramp up the tension from there. Let's say this is a middle grade fantasy book. So we might open with this bullying scene. Then we're getting that exposition, as I just mentioned. And then maybe the child discovers a portal. So this is the thing, that bullying scene is going to inform us a lot about our character. We're going to know a lot about the character from this interaction. So it's showing all of this kind of character development and we're getting a sense of who our protagonist is, even though that source of tension is not necessarily going to be then carried throughout the entire book. We might have little moments of reflection because this is informing the character, but this is not going to be an entire book about bullying, for example. How do you keep a book interesting throughout? Now, I think that there are multiple ways to keep a book interesting from beginning to end. Now, the most obvious answer is tension, and now tension can be created in a variety of ways. Think about how you might create tension within the environment. Is your character, is your protagonist safe in the environment that you have placed them in? What sort of obstacles or challenges is the environment creating for them? What sort of questions are at the heart of your novel? Is your character trying to solve some sort of external question? So who murdered that person? Why did they murder that person? Why is the world the way it is? Why do these systems exist in place? Why has this information been kept from us? What is the bigger motivation there? You can even create tension through having a two-person POV where the character storylines are not intersecting for the first, say, 75% of the novel. For that whole 75% of the novel, you're moving between these two points of view. And of course, you, the reader, are thinking, what's the connection here? When are these two characters going to meet? When are their lines going to cross over? So there are also these ways that you can create micro tensions within your text. And as I did speak about in the last video, you can consider external and internal tensions. So external tensions being events and circumstances that are happening outside of the character and that are outside of the character's control. And then they're trying to fix that situation or handle that situation in some way. And then you had their internal struggles. So their character limitations or character weaknesses, things that they're trying to overcome internally, self-doubt, low confidence, those types of things. So you don't necessarily want one form of tension to exist in your book, because then that can feel kind of flat. And that's how you're going to have your book feeling uninteresting, let's say. You can't maintain the tension if you only have one source of tension throughout your whole book. For example, if you have a hero and then a villain, and the villain is the only source of tension in the book, they're the only thing that is creating conflict, then you're going to have a pretty flat book. So you need to think about how you're creating these other forms of tension, either through mysteries and questions that are being posed, through the setting, what sort of threats is the environment creating for your character, as well as external and internal conflict. And of course, then you can also think about things like subplots and microplots as a way to add additional layers to your book. If you want to get very tricky, when you're working on your subplots, you can think about how those subplots are then going to connect and feed into the main plot. Now, this is something that could happen quite intuitively as you are writing, or this is something you can build into your manuscript when you're revising it. If you're the type of writer who is a very careful planner, then obviously this is something you can work out before you even begin your first draft. Which leads me into my next question. How do you create plot twists and how do you make them make sense? So I think this definitely kind of comes into your particular writing process. Are you an intuitive writer or are you a planner? Now, some people might fall into the trap of thinking that people who plan their novels are just more efficient because they're doing all of that thinking up front. So when they sit down to write, their work needs less, their manuscript needs less work. So when they sit down to write, because they've done all that thinking beforehand, their manuscript needs less revision. They've thought through all the plot holes, they've thought about who their characters are, they know what the general outline of the story is going to be and what all of their scenes are going to be, so now they're just writing it. And then their revision process is polishing it, rather than, say, fixing the structural issues with the book. If you are someone who writes intuitively, especially if you are someone who writes intuitively from beginning to end without editing in between, then it is highly likely that once your manuscript is done, and it will take you a lot less time to write that manuscript, but once that manuscript is done, you're then going to have a pretty lengthy revision process because you're going to be doing a lot of that thinking and structural work that the planner did before they started writing. Now, there is no one way to write. I'm personally someone who sits kind of in between an intuitive writer and a planner, and I think honestly most writers are a bit of a mix of the two. I think very few writers fall into total extremes. A lot of us are using tools and tricks from both camps. But the thing is, when we think about these binary oppositions, we might fall into the trap of thinking it's better to be a planner because you're figuring everything out beforehand. But ultimately, both ways, I think, end up being the same amount of time. You're just spending that time at different stages. You're either taking a long time to plan and to think about your book and then a shorter amount of time of writing that book, or you're spending a short amount of time writing that book and then you have a long revision process because then you're doing your thinking and you're figuring it out and fixing the manuscript. So why did I share all of that when it comes to plot twists? Now, I think you can include a plot twist in your book regardless of which camp you fall into. The initial thought might be that it's easier to include a plot twist if you are a planner. And there's probably some truth in that. If you are a careful planner, then you can figure out how to plant the seeds for that plot twist and how to plant them so that the reveal makes sense, but without maybe giving the reveal away too soon, unless you have a very clever and close reader. But I also think that you can make plot twists work if you are a discovery writer, but the reality is that you're going to be working on that plot twist during the revision stage. So, for example, you might get the insight for the plot twist while you're actually writing, which has happened to me, and it can be quite a fun moment when you're writing into something and then an idea you hadn't previously had suddenly reveals itself on the page. And if it's going to surprise you, the writer, then it's probably going to surprise the reader. But then you have to retroactively go back into the manuscript and make sure that you are planting the seeds or that you are constructing the first half of the book so that that plot twist actually makes sense and holds up and is logical. So how do you make a plot twist work? You either figure it out before you start writing or you fix it once you're in the revision stage and make it work then. So this is the thing, there's no magic bullet to this stuff. You just have to sit down and you have to do the work. And as I said in my past video, if there is an aspect that you want to include in your novel and you're not quite sure how to do it, the best thing you can do is go and find a book that has that aspect in it, study it, figure out how they did it, and figure out how you're going to make that your own within your particular book. So in the last video I posted, I shared my response to writer's block and how I don't really think writer's block exists. And now I wanted to extend upon that response because another student asked, how do you overcome writer's block and how can you avoid it even happening? And I was listening to a really great podcast with Carl Newport the other day, who has a podcast called Deep Questions, I'm pretty sure. And he was talking about writer's block and how he doesn't, like, writer's block is just writing. Like, the experience of writing block is just what it feels like to write. Like, it is just kind of hard to write. You kind of don't know what should come next. And that's all writer's block is just figuring out what thing should come next and figuring out how you make this thing in your brain text on a page. And I really loved that response, so I just kind of wanted to share it here. Now, I know that we have all had experiences of writing a scene where it feels more like dictation rather than active creation, where it feels like you're just writing down the scene that you're seeing in your mind. Now, those moments happen and they're really great, but a lot of times when we sit down to write, it can feel more like active effort. And I think sometimes people might fall into the trap of thinking that when you write, it should be easy. It should be inspiration and easy, and the words should come with minimal effort, and they should be good words. Whereas the reality is that writing actually takes effort and thought and care, and it can also still be playful. And this is the thing, we can't fall into the trap of thinking that if something is play, then it's not hard. Like, to play a game actually requires effort, and it takes thought and consideration and strategy and things like that. Like, that's how games function, and yet they're still fun. We might fall into the trap of thinking we just want everything to be easy, but that's actually kind of not what we want, I think. Or maybe I should speak for myself. I think we want a level of pleasurable challenge in the things that we're doing in our creative works. And I think that that is what writing is like. It's challenging, but it's fun at the same time. It's rewarding at the same time that it takes effort. So worrying about writer's block, maybe just accepting the fact that writing can feel uncomfortable because maybe you don't know what's going to come next, or you're doubting your skills or ability, you're doubting the quality or merit of this story. I think there is a level of writing where it's just accepting the discomfort of the actual act of writing. Sometimes writing is pure fun and it's just and it is easy. And then there's other times where it does require effort, and knowing that that is also okay, and that that writing session isn't less than the session that was pure fun and that was easy, and that it's more about your commitment to writing and coming back to the page again and again, even when you don't necessarily know what should be happening next. You're willing to sit in the chair and figure it out. Or feel it out, if you're more of a feeling person than a thinking person. So someone asked, how do you keep the book interesting even during boring daily tasks like walking to school, sleeping, driving, or brushing your teeth? So there's a couple of things here. One, you just eliminate that scene. Like, why are you including a scene with your character brushing their teeth? Now, it's okay to have these lulls or these quiet moments in books because we need to give our readers a break. You can't be just going from one event to one event to one event and keeping the tension high the entire time. You do need these like reprieves, these moments for your readers to catch their breath. Now, if you feel as though there are a number of scenes within your book that are quite quiet, that are just maybe two characters having an exchange of dialogue, and there's not much going on in the scene besides this to and fro conversation, or if you feel like these sort of like daily tasks, like going for a walk or driving, are not interesting enough, then you just need to think about, well, what could I do that makes sense that could make this a bit more interesting? So for example, I was just talking about games and play before. If you have two characters who are having an exchange of dialogue and you are concerned that this is going on for a long time and maybe the dialogue is not that interesting, that something else needs to be going on, then think about what that thing could be. Could it be them playing a game of chess? And so we're having these like multiple levels of action happening. So we're having the dialogue exchange and we're having them play chess as well, and this sort of like strategy. And then you can think about how the chessboard is a metaphor for their personal dynamic. So who's going to win? How's the other person going to react when that person wins? And what does this say about the winner and the loser and their dynamic together? So you can think about those kinds of things. How can I add an additional layer of stress or tension to this moment? I actually remember in a lecture somewhere online, Brandon Sanderson talking about how he had two characters in a bar having a conversation and it felt a bit lacking. So what he did was put a dartboard between them on the wall, and then between and behind them on the wall, and then another character was like throwing darts. So it's just like this other little source of action and tension in the scene that adds a bit more texture and excitement and interest and makes it a bit more dynamic, all the adjectives. So think about how you can maybe play with the scene in that way. Of course, this is going to be informed by, again, your genre, your voice, your style, who your characters are, their age, your audience, all that sort of stuff. But it's an opportunity for you to brainstorm and to meet this creative challenge of how can I make this small little moment more interesting, if you even need to. Now, I'm sure anybody watching this video will already know the answer to this, but a number of students on that particular day asked, how long does it take to write a book? And of course, there is no answer to this. I know Stephen King wrote one of his books in like a 2-week Coke binge, which, you know, I probably don't recommend. And then Ken Follett spent 10 years writing The Pillars of the Earth. So there's no answer to this. How long it takes you to write your book is completely dependent on you. So, and where you're at, what your skill levels are, what your lifestyle looks like, what your schedule looks like, how much writing time is even available to you, whether this is your first book or your 15th book, like all these factors are going to influence how long it takes you to write a book. And the thing is, that time will change with time. So your first book might take a long time because you're figuring out how to write the book. Your second book might be quicker because now you've got some skills and confidence. And then maybe your third book, you're halfway through and then you realize you got it wrong and you have to rewrite it and now it's going to take another year. So there's all these factors that can come into play when you're writing a book. And I think the thing is with this kind of question, how long does it take to write a book? It's very goal orientated. Like the focus is on the completion of the book. And while, of course, the publishing of a book is a completion of the writing process, because now it's going out there to readers and they are then consuming and responding to this text you've created. So we do want this. But I think being worried about how long it's going to take before you've even started is maybe the wrong question, and that it might be more rewarding and more satisfying to instead focus on the process of writing. How are you going to make writing enjoyable? Why do you want to write? Is it enjoyable? Do you even like doing this thing? So thinking about the process and what's happening right now, rather than some sort of like imaginary concerns around how long it's going to take. Because the thing is too, I personally think that writing is a valuable use of time. Like if you're not writing, then I mean, what would you be doing instead? And if somebody said, well, it's gonna take you 10 years to write this book, does that mean that you no longer want to write this book? That no longer seems like a meaningful use of your time? Would it only feel like a good use of time if it's only gonna take a year to write the book? And then when that book comes out, then what are you going to do? Are you going to write another one? Or is that it? You just wanted to see if you could do it once. So I think there's all these kinds of like interesting questions within that question and these sort of like implications around being really focused on the end rather than all the work of actually writing the book. So I think within that question, there's maybe a deeper question of why are you interested in writing? Do you have a writing practice? Is it a rewarding practice? If not, how can you make it one? Or is this something you even want to be doing with your time? So someone asked this and I thought it was great. Is it hard to make everything come together and make sense? Yes, it is. Next question. So obviously it is hard. Books are big. Even little books are big. A 50,000 word book is still, you know, it's not an essay. Many things happening in a book. You've got characters you need to think about. You've got your plot, your pacing, your tension. Is this even interesting? Theme. And then we're getting to the line level. So the level of language. Are these pleasing sentences? Is that even something you care about? I mean, it's something I care about, but not every writer writes like that. So there's all these sort of considerations when you're writing a novel, and I love that stuff. Now, someone else might be quite overwhelmed by the volume of things that you can think about when it comes to writing a book. I personally love all of the technical stuff. I had a very interesting conversation the other day about around whether the knowledge of technical stuff is helpful or a hindrance, which maybe I would make a video on in the future, but it is difficult. It takes effort. It takes effort to make a book function, to make a book hang well, to make it pleasing, to make it make sense. Of course, these things take effort. If they were super easy, then there would be a lot more people who have finished manuscripts. But I don't think we should shy away from the fact that something is hard. Like, do you really just want to spend your life sitting on the couch? Is that really what you want your creativity to be? And it is okay. Like, maybe you do want your creativity to just be this space that has no pressure on it. And that's perfectly fine. It depends. What do you want your creativity to do for you? What do you want storytelling to do for you? What is the purpose of you writing? All of these sort of like personal questions that, I mean, really only you can answer. Someone asked, what's it like being an author? It's great. So I'm pretty sure I didn't speak about this in the last video, but someone asked, how do you make your characters interesting? So when we think about characters, we can think about E.M. Forrester and what he says in relation to round characters and flat characters. So a flat character is a character that's quite simplistic. They don't change. They don't surprise us. If they're angry and cruel at the beginning of the book, they are angry and cruel at the end of the book. And as I just demonstrated there, they usually represent one single idea. They can also lean into stereotypes and cliches. So they're not very nuanced or complicated, essentially. Now, round characters are, of course, the opposite of all of that. They are complicated. They're not simple. They don't represent one idea. They represent many ideas. And just like real people, they have contradictions within them. Now, it's funny. I think there is a level of, say, writing theory that tells us characters need to be consistent. And characters do need a certain level of consistency so that we have a sense of who they are as a person. But the reality is all humans have contradictions, and it can be interesting to explore those within your character. I think round characters also surprise us, and because they're complex, we see these other facets of them. We might see them have a particular dynamic, say, with a parent figure, and then we might see them have a completely different dynamic with, say, a best friend, a boss, or someone who is maybe more of an antagonist. It can be really interesting to play with and to see how they respond to different people and different situations. And most importantly, round characters change. They're capable of change and they're capable of transformation. Now, this is one of the best ways to give your book, your story, a sense of purpose, is to have your character transform in some way. If you're writing, say, for a younger audience, middle grade or YA, then that level of transformation is going to be smaller. If you're writing middle grade, then your character might be developing some kind of skill, like they're learning how to build new friendships with people that they hadn't previously known, things like that. With YA, they might be developing a stronger sense of self, a stronger sense of identity. Maybe they're no longer trying to fit in with the crowd in order to be considered acceptable. Instead, they're learning to step more into their own uniqueness, because YA novels are very much about developing an identity and a sense of belonging and where you fit into society. And then if you're writing, say, like an adult novel, then that transformation could be more dramatic. It could be much more about a very much character growth, real character transformation. So transforming from someone who is like isolated and angry and cruel into someone who is now willing to have a group of community, a sense of community around them. So these are the sorts of things you need to think about with your character. And these might not be things you think about during the first draft of your book, or during the first sort of like initial planning of your book. but it is something worthwhile thinking during the revision stage, like how is my character transforming? How are they transforming in response to the obstacles, to the challenges, to the fire that I have put them through? So someone asked, do I personally use things around me for ideas for my stories? Like to a degree, I feel like there is a huge element of imagination in my stories, but then there's always little things that come up in the stories, certainly. And they could be quite literal things like, and this is a really dumb example, but I struggle to think of like basic things like street names and cars and things like that. I might quickly grab for something from my own life. So a street name that's familiar to me, a car that a friend drives, things like that. That obviously that's quite insignificant. But I think the bigger question here is probably in terms of emotion. And this is something I speak about a lot when I'm teaching memoir and biography classes, is something doesn't have to be factually true, but you want it to be emotionally true. And I think that's the thing that I'm more concerned with in my fiction, is that something feels emotionally true. Editing Tara here. So I just wanted to elaborate on that point around memoir and biography and the role of truth. So the thing with biography and memoir is you are striving for truth, but the reality is, particularly let's say with memoir, you are working off memories. Memories are slippery. If you actually included all of the events as they actually occurred, that could be a very unpleasing structure for a reader to consume. So instead, you're actively trying to curate and structure your own personal story in a way that you can package so that your product, which is your memoir, can then be pleasing to read. So that's what I mean, where you might curate and control the way you present your narrative. And even though you are striving for truth, the reality is what you have put down may not be the entire truth or the exact truth, but what you're striving for is emotional truth. So I may not have been, I've never been in any of the circumstances my characters have been in, but the emotion of what they're feeling within that situation is something familiar to me, and that's how I'm able to write it, and that's my link in to that character. And there's an element of it that definitely feels quite similar to acting, where there's this thread, a connection between you and the character, and it's enough of a thread that then you have access to them and you're sort of in this imagined character that you've created, and you're able to pretend, if I was this person and I was feeling this thing and I was in this situation, how would I respond? And that's more how I'm using ideas around me, or how I'm drawing from my own life when I'm writing fiction. Now, I think obviously this is completely different for every writer, and it's very different if you're writing autofiction, which is a very conscious blending of memoir and your personal life with fiction, to the point where it becomes quite ambiguous around what is true and what has been fictionalized or imagined. Now, this is the final question I'll answer. So somebody asked in class, is it better to be traditionally published or to be self-published? And there's no correct answer to this. What are your goals for the book? What are your personal circumstances? What is your skill set? What skills are you willing to learn or willing to develop? Now, I'm not going to go into big detail about traditional publishing versus self-publishing and the different avenues. But the thing you need to think about is, if you go traditional, you'll get a lot of support from that publishing house and you'll get paid in advance, but they are covering all of the upfront costs, so you will earn less royalties. You will get some support with marketing and advertisement if you are lucky, but the reality is you'll have to do a lot of that yourself. If you go with the self-publishing model, then you have to pay for everything upfront, but you earn more royalties. It also means that you have no support. You have to make every decision for yourself. So you need to figure out who's going to design the cover, who's going to do the interior formatting, who's going to edit this book, and then you're going to have to pay those professionals. Now, you don't have to do that. You can just put a book up without doing any of those steps, but it's not going to be, in my opinion, the best book that it could be unless you have those existing skills. Of course, there's caveats to everything with this stuff. The thing with self-publishing is I feel there is a narrative online that if you publish your book, it'll be successful. And the truth is that you also have to consider your discoverability. So both as a traditional published author and as a self-published author, you need to think about how are people going to find you? How are you going to reach your readers? So this is the one area, I think, with being an author where it's kind of the same playing field. There is a little bit of nuance here. Because you do get some support with traditional publishing, but ultimately you're going to be doing a lot of the work, really, especially if you're a debut author. So I think that this is the one element where it is a pretty even playing field for both camps. So you need to think about how will people find me? Can people find me online? What spaces online am I willing to give my time to? Am I willing to put energy into? I'm comfortable in those spaces. And then what traditional media might I approach? So newspapers, radio, TV shows, TV news, if you're in a small regional area, they actually might be quite interested in doing a story on you. You never know. As a former journalist, you need to fill space. So these might be things that you need to consider. Now, if you want to self-publish and you are quite interested in developing the skills required to do that, then I think it can be really rewarding and it can be really fun to feel like you are completely in control of your book and you like made this thing happen. And it also happens a lot quicker. Whereas with traditional publishing, you get a lot of support, but you also lose a great deal of control. You don't know when the book's going to come out. You've got very little say on the book cover, especially if you're a new author. Obviously, you've got a little bit more weight if you've been around for a while, but you're probably not watching my channel if that's the case. But it means that a lot of that kind of like production concerns have been taken off your plate because the publisher is taking care of all of that. So these are just some of the things you need to think about. There's other things that go into the mix, but that's just on a very basic surface level, the pros and cons of both camps. And I don't think either one is better than the other. It absolutely depends on you and your skills, your goals for the book, your timeline. As I mentioned, traditional publishing, if you sold a book today, it probably wouldn't come out for 18 months to 2 years. Finding a publisher to sell your book takes a lot of time as well, whereas you might want to get your book out a lot faster than that. And if you go with self-publishing, you're largely in control of that timeline, with the exception of the professionals that you hire to work with you. So the editor, the cover designer, things like that. All right, everyone, that was my final question. Thank you so much for watching this video. If you want to chime in on any of my responses that I gave, maybe extend on anything that I said or share your own experience, feel free to tell me all about it in the comments below. If you'd like even more writing advice, you can of course check out the other videos on this channel or head to taraeast.com and dive into the archives. While you're there, please consider joining my email newsletter. When you do, I'll send you a free gift, plus you'll receive an email in your inbox whenever I write one, and this will include a note by me, a quote of the week, some resources I've recently discovered and loved and think you will too, as well as some other tidbits that I only share via email. Thank you so much for watching this video. I hope it was enjoyable and useful. Now go do some writing, because the world really does need more books.